couple of years ago, my husband was gifted a virtual reality headset. Do any of you, are any of you familiar with this or maybe have one at home?
Virtual reality, yes. So it's like a headpiece, like a goggles thing that you put over your face, and there's music that pipes into your ears. And basically, whatever you're seeing, you're sort of transported into this virtual world. And whenever you move your body, your character moves in whatever game you're playing. So one of the first things that we downloaded on this device was this game called Plank. It's basically you walk into an elevator in this virtual reality world, and it takes you all the way up to the top of a building. The doors open, and in front of you, there's a plank of wood, and right over the edge is the city below. And the challenge is to walk the plank and jump off the edge. Shortly after we got this game, my family came to visit, and my dad, who is afraid of heights, gave it a shot. He spent so much time inching across our living room and sort of going like, oh, and then like backing up. And then he would try it again, and he would like lean away and sort of inch closer. And eventually he made it with the help of a shove from my sister. It really is wild, though. As the daughter who inherited my dad's fear of heights, I have to say, when the headset is on your head, it's very different. It's great and fun and fine and easy to laugh at people as they inch their way across your living room until you're in the world, until you're in the story. Our scripture reading today, I think, is one of those situations. With our feet on hard ground and our seat comfortably still in our pews, I think it's easy for us to judge Peter, to ask why he didn't just trust God more. Today's scripture reading has been the source of plenty of Christian finger wagging throughout the years. But I think it's easy for us to underestimate the intensity of the situation that Peter found himself in. The disciples had gotten in a boat together that afternoon, expecting to just sail across the Sea of Galilee to the other side, a simple, straightforward trip. But the wind picked up, and it stirred the waves, and the waves started battering the boat and rocking it violently back and forth, threatening it to capsize. And as day fell into night, the disciples were trapped, tossing and turning with no light and no way home. So by the time Jesus reaches the boat in today's story, Peter isn't just unsure or skeptical. Peter is terrified. The legs shaking, stomach turning, sleepless nights kind of terrified. The disciples had seen Jesus calm storms before. See, earlier in the gospel, they were traveling again by boat, but Jesus was aboard. And when they were struck with some intense wind and rain, they woke him up, and somehow he calmed the storm, and they were able to make it safely to shore. But this time, Jesus is far away, and they are utterly alone. So when they realize that Jesus is somehow walking on water, headed in their direction, of course, Peter wants to climb out of the boat and run to him. He knows that Jesus can take care of this. I wonder if Peter was just trying to get to Jesus as quickly as humanly possible, or maybe after being trapped and powerless for so long, Peter just wanted to do something, anything. So he asks Jesus to command him to walk on the water. Peter might not understand how Jesus does all the stuff he does, but Peter is a good disciple, and he knows that if his rabbi tells him he can do something, he can do it. And what's the harm in asking? Peter wants to do everything possible to follow in Jesus' footsteps, maybe even this. So when Jesus does invite him to step out onto the water, Peter initially doesn't hesitate. He leaves the relative safety of the boat to take the wild risk of running after his Savior. But then he stumbles. He notices the wind and begins to sink. And immediately he cries out to be saved. And Jesus is there to catch him. He says, "Lord, save me." And Jesus steadies him and turns to him and asks, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?"
So often we jump to the conclusion that Jesus is chastising Peter here, as though a good disciple would simply step out onto the water without an ounce of fear. But Jesus doesn't say, "Do not doubt," or "How dare you doubt?" He simply asks, "Why? Why did you doubt?" I imagine him asking gently, with curiosity, like a concerned friend or mentor, "You were doing so well. What happened? Why did you doubt?" Which raises another question. Doubt who? Jesus? After all, Peter did what no other disciple had the conviction to do. So strong was his trust in Jesus, when he was called, Peter got out of a boat and walked on water toward Jesus. And when he started to sink, Peter cries out to Jesus to save him. I don't think that Peter is doubting Jesus. Beloved, Peter doubts himself. Peter has been called and set apart by Jesus as Petros, the rock, the firm foundation of this movement that they are building together, and he goes out of his way time and time again to learn and do everything that he can as a disciple. It's this spirit that leads Peter to take those first steps outside of the boat. He wants to follow his rabbi, but then the imposter syndrome sets in. He notices the wind and the waves, and he thinks, "What am I doing? This is crazy. Jesus is wrong about me." And he goes under. There's this quote from Gandhi that I cannot stand. It goes like this. "Nothing wastes the body like worry, and anyone who has any faith in God should be ashamed to worry about anything whatsoever." No offense to Gandhi, but I think he got this one wrong. In my experience, anxiety doesn't make it hard to trust God, it makes it hard to trust yourself. I recently learned about a study that was done on something called the fundamental attribution error. Basically, it's this human tendency to assume that when others mess up, it's because of something foundational about them. That person arrived late because they are rude or lazy or disorganized. But when we mess up, it's because of outside factors. I arrived late because of the traffic, because someone stopped me on my way out the door. I'm not usually like this, you see. And in large quantities, you can see how this is a harmful cognitive bias. But in small quantities, it's also self-protective. It helps us be more gentle on ourselves when things go wrong. But here's the thing. This study found that people with anxiety and depression tend to think the opposite way. They tend to make excuses for other people and decide that their own failings are foundational. Other people are late because something must have happened, but we're late because we're lazy and disorganized. When Peter stumbles, he doesn't think, "Oh, that wind was really strong there for a second," or, "Whoops, I tripped a little bit. This is really hard." Instead, he thinks, "I can't do this. I don't belong here." So Jesus rescues Peter and asks him, "Why did you doubt?" And this, I think, is the moment in the story, this question that tells us the most about who Jesus is. More than walking on water, more than calming the storm, this is Jesus as Savior, as healer. Jesus's ministry is not just in feeding crowds or curing diseases. It is also in these moments, when he sees people and calls them into the fullness of who they are. Why did you doubt? Faith, ultimately, is not about the miraculous, but about the relational. To be a believer is less about whether you think that Jesus actually walked on water and more about whether Jesus' love has changed your life. Today we had the joy of baptizing 4 children into the Christian church. Baptism is a declaration of what is already true. God sees and calls these children as beloved exactly as they are. And as a community, we commit to treating these young ones with that same love and affirming it as they grow through their life. And we tell them we cannot promise that this life will be easy, but we can promise that we will be there in the midst of the messiness. The waters of baptism represent the roiling waters of creation. In our creation story, God hovers over these waters and pulls the world out of the chaos below. Just like in today's story, Jesus walks over the water and pulls Peter out of the chaos below. So, beloved, the waters of baptism are our reminder that without the storm, there is no miracle. Without the chaos, there is no creation. So the question is, what is being created in the midst of your storms? What are you being called to step out into on faith? Faith in God, but also faith in yourself. I want to close by offering you a Bible verse that is very precious to me as one anxious disciple to any others who might be out there today. This is from Proverbs chapter 3, verses 25 through 26. Do not be afraid of sudden panic or of the storm that strikes the wicked, for the Lord will be your confidence and will keep your foot from being caught. Holy wisdom, holy word. Won't the church say amen?